Hey, everybody. Welcome back. Devin, the original Grognard, Grognard's Corner, sitting in the actual Grognard's Corner. And we've got the game on the table that we're going to be taking a look at next. I pronounced the name of the game wrong last time. I called it the Scheldt Campaign. It's actually the Scheldt Campaign. I guess Scheldt sounds more cool in German. But it is the Scheldt Campaign. Probably one of the reasons why I kind of mispronounced it. It is mainly a German, or it is mainly a British-Canadian operation. Apologies to my British and Canadian listeners, but I just never really paid too much attention to the British and Canadian aspects during World War II. I kind of found them to be boring. I guess it all kind of started when I first started researching World War II, and I actually was reading several books on the North Africa campaign, and it wasn't very thrilling and exciting to me. It was more thrilling and exciting to read about Kasserine and all that other stuff. Hey, I was 12. What do you expect? So apologies, because the British, my British and Canadian war experiences of World War II are somewhat lacking. Please don't hate me for that. So, anyways, we're going to be going ahead and jumping into this. Now, I will say right off the bat, this is not the best game to be played solitaire. There is a command mechanic where each side selects operations chits for each turn, or actually a turn in advance of what they're going to do. And they do this without the opponent's knowledge, so you never know what your opponent's going to be selecting. It kind of goes to the command and control. The British forces have 7 operation markers that they can conduct operations with. The Germans have 4. So starting off the game, both sides need to kind of select what they're going to do for the first turn. And as soon as their turn is over, they go ahead and select the command chits for the next turn. So it's got a pretty cool command and control fog of war like that, which I think would be really cool in head-to-head play. However, I'm not playing head-to-head. I am playing versus myself. So I'm going to have to try to play both sides the best of my abilities. I tried coming up with different ways of doing it, you know, just randomly selecting the chits, randomly selecting half the chits, what have you. But I just eventually came down and decided, you know what, I'm just going to pull the chits to the best of my knowledge, best of my ability, and play myself without, you know, my deus ex machina knowledge about what's going on the other side, which, you know, is probably a pretty good chance of me doing that, because I'm usually not sure what I'm doing most of the time anyways. Anyway, so what we've got laid out here, since the British get to go first, I've already went ahead and selected the 7 British operation chits, and they're 4 different operation chits. Or you've got your G1, which are admin, which you can use that to enter reinforcements. You can regroup units within a given area. That's also within task forces can reorganize with units that are adjacent to them. And they can also recover tactical units. And the difference, you have task forces and tactical units. Task forces are the actual task group markers that go along with the order of battle sheets, where you keep track of multiple units in a hex. That's the task force. Then tactical units are just normal individual, you know, company battalion sized units that are on the field by themselves. So the G1 units you can also use to, so G1 is inner reinforcements, regroup task forces, and get reinforcements to tactical units. Basically, you play a G1 admin counter, roll a D3, you get that many hits back. Because as I kind of went over last time, as we can see with this unit right here, they've got 1 hit on them already. So if I wanted to bring them back up to full strength, I'd play a G1 counter, roll a D3, get that many hits back. And you can play these counters multiple times in the turn. Now, you are kind of limited. Overall, the British only have 3 G1 counters, period. So, they're limited in how often they can do that. The Germans are also limited to only 3 G1 counters. However, that's where things kind of are similarities in. I believe the British only have two G4s or G2s, where the Germans have like four or five G2s. So the countermixes between the commands are different, and you're only limited to the amount of counters you have. So since you only have three G1 admin counters, a player could only play three G1 admin counters in a turn. G2 is kind of the big one for multiplayer. It can be used to conduct tactical intelligence activities or to take and recover tactical advantage in battle, kind of be getting into that. Most of the time, the defender always goes first in combat. Unless the attacker throws out a G2 marker, then he goes first, unless the defending player also throws a G2 marker out there. This is kind of where the fog of war goes into play, because at the beginning of each combat, both sides secretly choose if they want to commit a G2 marker, and if nobody commits a G2 marker, it's the defender. If either player commits a G2 marker, it's whoever committed it. If they both commit the G2 marker, then it defaults to the defending player. So there's a little bit of psychological warfare that goes on with the G2 markers. For trying to see who goes first in combat. But you also use it in head-to-head play to be able to take a look at your opponent's tactical displays. Now, normally, your tactical displays are kind of hidden from view, so you can't really see what the opponent's task forces are. Using the G2 allows you to take a look at the opponent's tactical sheet for like 30 seconds, I think it is. Then you got G3. G3s are the most prevalent. You can either conduct movement or conduct an attack. So you're going to have lots of those. And G4 logistics is you can do a strategic move, which is basically tripling the move of one of your units. Or you can provide combat support for your forces in battle, which is for the both sides. You can call in artillery, all artillery that's in range. And I guess I kind of go over that a little bit right now. We have some German artillery units. Lots of German artillery units. So, of course, these are artillery units, coastal batteries, and normal artillery. But you've got the first number is the attack number, then you've got this little subscript in the upper right-hand corner of it. That's basically the range of that artillery. So you got this coastal artillery. It's got a 1-4, so it's got a 1 attack factor, but it can shoot out to a range of 4 hexes. Basically, if you use a G4 marker, you can call in all artillery that is within range of a hex that you're attacking, and all that artillery can join in. Also, the allies can just flat out play it for airstrikes. I think allies can play two G4 markers per attack, one for artillery and the other one for airstrikes, which gives them just a flat out 3 extra dice. So that's kind of the basic overview of the command sheets and what they do. And like I said, since we'll go ahead and start into the game, turn one, I already decided for the Germans and the British what they're going to be doing. So that's actually the command that I pulled for the British. And for the Germans, I went with three G1s, which is basically Germans are going to be reinforcing. And they've got a lot of units. They've got a lot of hits on them. So we need to try to get some replacements back to them. And a G4 logistics, just so I can, in case there's an attack someplace, that I can bring in some artillery, you know, to kind of bolster the defenses a little bit. Basically, the game goes for 32 turns or until the British are able to destroy all the coastal batteries on Walacheren Island. And I know I'm butchering that horribly. I have a good close friend of mine who lives over in Europe, kind of in the area, so I'm sure he's going to be wincing every time I try to pronounce these lowlands, Belgian, Dutch, well, not Dutch, but these names. So Hans, I apologize in advance. You know how I am. So 32 turns, or whenever all the coastal batteries on the island are destroyed, and then you figure out victory points. Mostly, for the most part, victory points comes down to units destroyed. If Germany can hold certain cities and towns over here, which, you know, they probably won't be able to, they get victory points for that. Both sides have special units that they can kind of commit. The British forces have got, geez, 3 or 4 different tactical or task forces they could commit, but doing so will give the German player points. There's paradroppers that they can do, but that'll give the German points. There's the British can uh, can destroy the locks, which gives a chance, well, which will flood the island and has a chance to flat out destroy the coastal batteries. You roll a d6, I think it's a 5 or a 6, and destroys the coastal battery. However, it turns each hex into flooded terrain, so it makes it harder for the British to push into there. But, you know, 1 in 3 chance of knocking out each coastal battery. So there's a whole bunch of different things that either side can do that'll give the other person victory points. But basically, it comes down to the British get the most victory points for capturing the island, and whatever turn they capture the island on, whatever, however many turns are left, that's how many victory points they get, and then you count up destroyed units and all that other stuff. Not even going to get into it now, just a whole host of victory points, and then compare them and see who wins. So yeah, that's... I guess as the game progresses, I will be explaining more and more of the mechanics as we go along. Again, I want to remind everybody, this is not a learn how to play through. This is a see it played with the idiot behind the camera messing up the rules probably quite often. So be gentle, be forgiving. This is just me playing. I'm going to make mistakes. I'll try to point them out in future videos. If you've seen my videos before, you know I make mistakes. So anyway, so we're going to go ahead and start off. Game turn one. Woo! So it's game turn one. British have control, and we've got all these lovely markers. So what do we want to do first? Now that's the cool thing, is because as the player, you can decide which ones you want to play, when you play it, however you play it. What we're going to do first, I think, is we're going to go ahead and play the G1 admin straight off the bat. Let me go ahead and pull these down a little bit. Let's go ahead and leave them there. Sharp observant players will automatically notice the battle is kind of divided into two fights. We've got the fight over here and the fight over here. There's not much in the middle. So we're basically got two battlefields we're going to be fighting over. I have a feeling the Canadians over here are going to be pushing, you know, up this estuary and to get into the island real quick. Oh, one thing I do need to point out, this little pocket right here. As soon as the British and Canadians manage to destroy all five coastal batteries, all the German units in this pocket immediately surrender. So the Germans need to figure out, all right, how well do we defend? How much do we defend? And when do we start pulling back to the island proper? So that's just something I didn't want to point out. So I've got the G1, and so I'm going to use that for reinforcements. And like I said, I wish I had a better camera set up here, but I don't. So, but we've got the, I believe that's the 3rd Canadian up there. They've got one unit that's got 3 hits on it. Yeah, it's the 3rd Canadian. So, we're going to use that to reinforce them. So, we roll a d6. And the dice roll is a 4. So, that's going to be 2 hit points back. So, they're going to get 2 hit points back. And this is where it's going to get a little bit difficult, because I am rapidly running out of 1s and 2s. Hit markers. But, all right, so that's easily enough done. That's one command out of the way. So we got G2s, G3s, and G4s. So G2, I'm going to hold on to that for an attack, since I don't need to use it for its intelligence to look at the opponent's chart, because, well, I'm playing against myself and I know what the charts are. So basically going to be using that to try to rest initiative in combat. G4 logistics, again, use that for combat if I need to throw some air or throw artillery in. The rest of it's all going to be movement and combat. So let's go ahead and take a look over here first off, because we got 4 British units over here. 2 task force, the 3rd and the 4th, and then a couple detached units, the 8th Infantry, and then the 9th Infantry right here. And the 9th Infantry actually has some naval, well, not naval, amphibious transports attached to them. Those are Buffaloes, and I can't remember what the other special designation was, but it basically allows them to do amphibious movement. So I'm probably going to hold these guys kind of in reserve for right now. I mean, there's a part of me that says, yeah, let's just go ahead and bum rush them over here and start rampaging through the backside of the German forces here on this island and see what damage I could do. But Single company. Actually, it's a battalion. Single battalion. I don't think they're going to do much well on their own. So we're just going to hold those guys in kind of reserve. And these guys, I mean, the only thing they got really in range is an enemy task force. I don't think a single infantry battalion wants to take on a German task force, even though the German task force probably is kind of damaged at this point. But what we are going to do is we are going to take the 3rd and 4th, I believe it's the 3rd and 4th Canadian. Yeah, 3rd and 4th Canadian. And so let's go ahead and start off by burning one of the G3 markers to have the 3rd Canadian attack the 1038th Company. Is that battalion? Company? Whatever. I should probably look at that. I should know that. I should know what those tick marks are for unit sizes. Battalion, regiment, brigades. Okay. So that's what is that? That's 3 tick marks, so that's a regiment. So 3rd Canadian is going to go ahead and attack that regiment in Ede. And so technically what you do is you take the battle marker and we go ahead and throw it on there like that. And then you would go over to the battle sheet, which is that sheet way over there, which I'm not going to do because it's just going to be a pain in the butt. So what I'm going to do is kind of a ghetto version of combat and just set them off to the side here. And so we're going to take the 3rd, units from the 3rd, which is these guys right here, against them. And we're going to go ahead and go into combat. And of course, you know, I marked it with a little battle marker over there for me to remind myself where the battle is at. The British are not going to commit their G2 or their G4. And the Germans are not going to do it either. The Germans are kind of in defensive mode right now. So now we have to look at how many dice we're actually into combat. Comes down to how many dice each side is going to have. Now, defender always gets to go first, unless, you know, the attacker plays, you know, the G2 marker, which we didn't do. So the numbers on the counters are attack value on the attack, or combat value on attack, combat value on defense, and movement. And it's taken one step loss, so its attack and defense values are reduced by 1. So he actually has got a 3. So that means he gets 3 dice to throw in combat. And I will tell you right now, get buckets of dice. You're going to need a lot of dice in this one. So let's just go ahead and roll. A 5 is a single hit. A 6 are 2 hits. So we rolled a 4-5-2, so we managed to inflict 1 hit on the enemy. So the defender, or whoever's being attacked, whoever's receiving the hit, gets to decide who takes the hit. We'll go ahead and put the hit right here. Now the attackers get to do their attack. And so we're looking at 6 minus 2 is 4, 7 minus 1 is 6, and 3 minus 2 is, or 3 minus 1 is 2. So we've got 10, 12 dice. We're going to be throwing 12 dice. Again, looking for 5s and 6s. However, if you take a look at the terrain we're fighting in, we are attacking across a river. Ooh, okay, that's into a polder. Ooh, I don't think I can commit the armor to attack. Let me check that real quick. There's something special with polders, which are basically real nasty marshlands with basically 1 or 2 elevated roads through it. Polder! Okay, flooding. Trying to favor the defender. Okay, that doesn't tell me anything. I think it's under mechanized. Combat support, parachute. All right, let's look at the index. Special rules and situations. That's probably what it's under. Fortifications, parachute, planning. Oh my god, I was just reading the polder. I thought I had it right. I don't think I can attack into the polder unless I'm attacking along the road. This can be land reclaimed from body water, floodplain separated by sea, river, dike, drained marshes, swamp in this area of the Netherlands, or carefully maintained system of dikes. Soon broke down, flooding many areas more or less severely, while the only places vehicles and guns could move and deploy was via the straight and very exposed roads running atop the dikes. Certainly terrain that favored the defender. Alright, let me put this on pause while I try to find the actual effects of the polder. Okay, yeah, mechanized units can only attack into a polder along the road, but since we're attacking from here, mechanized will not be able to attack. So that does change things a little bit, but still, we are attacking into a polder, into a fortification hex, and across a stream. This may not have been the brightest idea ever. So, taking a look at our terrain chart. Okay, we're attacking into a polder, so that gives two defense to the defender. I'll get into that in a little bit. We're attacking across, let's see, a canal. No, that's not a canal. What is that defined as? That would be defined as a canal, yeah, which is another plus one. And into a fortification, which is another plus one. All right, so that basically gives the defender, attacking across there basically gives the defender 4 points of defense. We'll get into that, how that defense works when we roll the dice. So basically these guys can't attack, so they couldn't take any casualties. So we've got 4, 5, 6 dice. So we're throwing 6 dice. I've only got 4 in my hand. And I will probably be pulling out much more dice as the game progresses. Okay, so far we've got 2 hits with the 6. And 1 more hit with the 5, so that's a grand total of 3 hits. Unfortunately, the defender has a defense of 4. And so for each point of defense, that negates 1 hit that the unit suffers. So defense of 4 against 3 hits inflicted. So basically, we had no effect. The attacker was not able to do anything to the defender. And that ends that combat, and so he will go back to the hex that we had the battle marked on, and the surviving units will go back to the task force display, and to mark that they've already done something, I'll go ahead and just cock him sideways like that. So, that attack was kind of pointless. But let's look what we got next. Basically, what we're looking at, it's going to kind of be the same thing with the fourth. If I do the attack across there, the fourth, has the fourth got, let me take a look. The fourth has no mechanized. So the fourth doesn't really have to worry about that. All right, so they can attack into that polder hex with no problem. So let's go ahead and spend another G3 marker to do another attack. We're going to have the 4th Canadian attack into this hex here. Just go ahead and pull it off to the side. There. Let's pull the 4th Canadian stuff off. And line them. Now, like I said, normally what you would do is you'd line this up on the battle mat, but since, you know, the battle mat is way over there and my camera setup is crap, we're just going to go with right here. Okay, now let's see. That's a special type of infantry. What kind of special type of infantry is that? Oh, that's motorized infantry. Well, balls. That means they can't. You know, all right, we're going to change that. We're instead. So the motorized isn't going to be able to attack across that hex side because it's attacking into the polder. So what we'll do instead is we'll put the units back. And he's going to tactically move. And kind of a little bit fuzzy on how, they don't call it zones of control, they call it operational something or other. But for all intents and purposes, it's zones of control. Let me go ahead and check. I'm not sure I can move from one zone of control to another. So let me see that real quick under movement. Tactical movement. In this procedure, a player may move his units from hex to hex, from hex to adjacent hex in an operations phase. Every unit has a movement factor expressed in movement points, and every hex on the map has an associated cost in movement points to enter it, or in some cases to cross a hex side. See the terrain effects chart. Movement is voluntary, but a unit must stop when it runs out of the MPs. MPs may not be saved, yada, yada, yada. A given unit may conduct tactical movement only once per player turn. A unit must stop when it enters a hex containing an uncontested enemy operation zone, that's the zone of control. That is, the hex in question is both vacant and adjacent to an enemy TF. A unit may never enter a map containing an enemy unit. Units may not move off the map. Okay, so it says I have to stop as soon as it enters a hex containing an uncontested enemy occupational zone. So I'm guessing that means that I can just go ahead and move right there. Rules as written, it doesn't say I can't move through it. It just says I have to stop as soon as I move into, since this is the first movements it's doing, move one hex, yada, yada, yada. Okay, so there's that. Now, I believe I can go ahead and do, just because I moved with him, I believe I can attack with him again. Let's check real quick. Okay, it says one friendly unit, again, this may be a single tactical unit or an entire task force, may either conduct tactical movement or conduct an attack. You can only do one tactical movement. So I'm going to guess that I can do, spend another ops chit, another G3, to attack with him. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And now, 4th Canadian is going to be following the road across the canal, into the polder, and to the fort. So let's go ahead and do what we tried to do last time when we noticed that those guys were motorized. Okay, so now they're following the road. So now I'm gonna... Okay, now the cool thing is 4th Canadian has got some engineers with them. Now, they don't provide any combat dice. However, they do reduce the defense of the hex by one. So, looking at the terrain effects chart again. Let's see if I can get this in here so people can see it. So, we've got terrain, one movement point, no combat, woods, two movement points, two defense, polders, three movement points, and two defense, flooded, three, yada, 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 on down, on down, on down. So, they're attacking across a canal, which is going to give it plus one defense. We're attacking into a fortification, which is going to give it plus one defense. And it is a polder, which is going to give it two defense. So it's going to have four defense just like the last unit we fought against. However, with this engineering unit, we're going to reduce that by one. So their defense is going to only be three. You know what? I think the Germans or the Allies are going to burn their G2 to give them the advantage in combat. And the Germans do not have any G2 counters to or markers to counter that. So that means they are going to, the British are going to get the advantage in combat, and that means they are going to attack first. So we've got 5, 9, 10, 11. So we've got 11 dice we're throwing. Remember what I said about getting buckets of dice? So there's 4. We got one hit. We got no more hits. 8. And we got 3 more dice. Okay, 9, 10. So we got 2 hits with that 6. So we managed to do 3 hits. Unfortunately, I have a defense of 3. So the Germans aren't going to take any casualties. The Germans are going to return because we're with 3 dice because they use the middle number as the defense. Since they're on defense, they use the defense value, which is 4 minus 1 for step loss, so they get 3 dice. And they inflict 2 casualties. Ooh, that's not good. because we can't inflict one casualty on either one of those artilleries because that'll kill them. So we're going to have to put both casualties on the 10th. So they... Let's see if I can find a neg 3 counter. They are now at a 3-step loss. I should probably point that out. When the defensive number is reduced, or when you take as many hits equal to your defensive combat value, then you're destroyed. Well, I should probably have pointed that out earlier. All right, so 3rd Canadian goes back to their task force chart, not having accomplished anything. So really, the British have not really accomplished anything this turn yet. Both attacks, what I probably should have done is move this guy to here so I could have gotten the... I think I could still do that. I got one G3 and one G4 left, but we got action over here. Let's see what we got. We got Poles, Canadians, 2nd British. Let's see. You know what? Let's see, what's that? Oh, that is a Polish unit. So I can do one attack or one movement. And yeah, that probably should have thought this out a little bit more. You know what? Let's just go ahead and spend the G3 over here to move him across the river, across the canal. And so we're moving across the canal. Make sure we got the points for it. Two movement points to cross. And the 3rd Canadian... the slowest movement is a 3, so yeah, they'll be able to get across. Yeah, task forces only move at the whatever their slowest member or slowest formation is. So that now means we got the G4 left over, which I could strategic move one unit. I got my G4 left. Should have used that. I was not thinking clearly. But this is kind of the cool thing about the game, is because you kind of got to plan out, and if you're not paying attention, you're going to have bad commands that it's like, oopsie, that didn't work out as planned. But hey, you know, that's command and control. That's kind of real life. Or provide combat. Yeah, I wanted to use it as combat support, but I still can use it as strategic movement. But I wouldn't be able to move next to an enemy. Yeah, even at strategic movement. All right, so basically the British turn is done. And now what I have to do is I have to decide what command markers I want to use for next turn. All right, so we know, looking at our sheets up there, we know one of our units has taken 3 hits. See if I can get that in. He's taken 3 hits, and we don't like having him taking 3 hits, because really the only other 2 formations there are 2 artillery and an engineering unit. So he needs to get he needs reinforcements. So we're going to definitely have at least one G1 counter for him to repair him. And I think we also want another G1 command counter to replace the infantry that's damaged, or the motor, the infantry that's damaged in 2nd Canadian. And we can get 2 attacks across off here. So let's go ahead and do 2 G3 command markers with that. And you know what? I want a G4 because I want the combat support with the airstrike. I need those 3 extra dice because we've not been doing too well. So that's a 5 markers we've spent so far. And we've got 2 commands left over here. Well, not over here, but I think we need to pay some attention over here. So I think I'm going to take 2 more G3 markers for over there to start moving some of the British and Polish Canadian task forces over here, start moving them up. So that's what we're looking at next turn. We got a couple G1s, G4, and a bunch of G3s. And again, if this was head-to-head, this would be done. This would be chosen in secret. As you can see, the back of these just have staff markers, so you can't really see what your opponent's grabbing. And honestly, I really kind of like that mechanic. I kind of like that command and control fog of war mechanic. But now we're looking at the Germans. The Germans only have a command rating of 4, so they only get 4 markers. And we went with 3 G1s and a G4. So the G1s, we're going to be using those to reinforce and resupply units that are down. And right off the bat, we're going to... We got that unit right there, which my knee-jerk reaction, I want to say the 716th. Nope, it's the 85th Infantry. We're going to commit 2 of the G1 markers to replace those 2 units that are down 3. So let's go ahead and I'll just roll for both of them. Get D3 back. So one of them will get 1 back. The other will get 2 back. And so one of them will get 1 back. And the other will get 2 back. And I think we want to use one of the other G1 admin markers on this formation here. And let's see, what do we got? We got infantry. So we'll just go ahead and the first infantry unit, we'll go ahead and reinforce a little bit or resupply with 1. So we'll get 1 point back. And that means we've got a G4 marker left, which I was going to throw into combat. If I needed the artillery, but it looks like I didn't need the artillery, but I can use that for a strategic move someplace. I can do a strategic move, and that actually is not a bad idea. Over here, let's take a look. I got the 64th here, and really they're kind of only holding the road to keep these 2 British units from advancing. Now, the 64th, what does the 64th have in it? The 64th has got 1 artillery and 3 very weak infantry units. So I can try moving him back, or now, because I'm going to have to keep this unit here. I got to keep those three canals occupied with troops because I don't want the British to just be able to move right over them. Let's see, what have we got in here? I've got that infantry unit that I can move up. But where to? Now, let's go ahead and leave him there for now. I think these guys over here are set. So let's take a look at the guys we've got over here. Kind of got the 346th here that's not really doing much. I can pull him back, maybe kind of come over here and threaten the flanks of the British and the Canadians. 711th, I mean... Yeah, I think these 2 units are good candidates to pull back some. But, I mean, right now, I mean, I'm zone of control, they'll only be able to move 1 hex into there, so if I move him, then he's going to be able to take advantage. So, really, the 346th and the 711th are really the only 2 I can look at moving. Yeah, let's go ahead and move the 346th. What do they have in it? 346th. Has got a movement 3 is all over the place, so I can... Well, they're not going to be very far at all. Let's take a look. Okay, so it's going to be 1 to move to there. And then Rhodes is half movement point. So I can go 2, and then let's go here for 3. And that'll give me a little bit more defense to keep the British and the Canadians from pushing. All right, so that is it for the German turn. So I have to decide what I want to do with my counters for next turn. Again, whoops. I think I just lost one of the... Yep, there it is on the ground. Again, I've got... The Germans don't have the strength to do any counterattacks yet. I will be getting some of the... I think it's... No, it's the Hermann Göring. Hermann Göring and 6 Fallschirmjägers. They're about the only units that I'm going to be getting later that can go on the attack. So I'm not worried about going on the attack right now because I don't have any units in position. So let's go again with 3 G1s so I can get units built back up to full, or at least try to get them built back up to full strength. And that's all the G1s because I only have three G1 commanders or counters. And then, yeah, let's go with the G4 again, just in case I need to call in artillery support or need to strategically move. So I could go with a G2 in case the... Nah, let's just go with that. All right, folks. So turn one is over. We advance it to turn two. And that's kind of a basic idea and overview so far of how the game is played. I don't know if I'm going to get through all 32 turns, but we're sure as hell going to try. This is a very, very slow plotting game. If you're a fan of blitzkrieg strikes and lightning breakouts and grand wild flanky maneuvers, you're not gonna like this game. But I mean, it kind of mimics historically. I mean, it was a very, very painful and slow plotting advance that the British, Canadians, and Poles undertook when taking the island and working their way up the estuary. So it the command and control definitely mimics history rather well. So that's all we've got for the first turn. Questions, comments, concerns, complaints, criticisms in the comment section. And I will talk to everybody later. Yeah.